Hello, everyone. Thank you, I've become accustomed to that. So, everyone is kind of joined here together tonight. We're here in the theater. The front doors have been locked. And I can kind of start talking about what I've been always wanted to talk about. My personal Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So, strap in. So let me first begin talking about what this whole night is going to be about and why it even came up in the first place. Part of it is because I am crazy, legitimately crazy, and I wanted to do this for so many years. And the reason why I'm doing it now, and I was having a conversation with a friend earlier today at work, I should also point out I have no idea what I'm going to be talking about for the next 3 minutes, so I'm just going to blabber on until we actually start the show. Is this. So for like 6-7 years, I've always been like, I want to do a live show. I want to do a live show. I want to put this thing on. What that thing was, I hadn't really fully figured that out yet, but I knew I wanted to do it. And so over the last couple of years, specifically when I turned 30, I was like, I'm not dealing with this very well. The fact that I'm 30 years old, I'm not really doing exactly what I want to be doing for the rest of my life, and I need to make a change. And I don't know if anyone has seen it before. It's a fairly popular kind of viral video that's on YouTube of Jim Carrey doing his commencement speech. And I'm going to paraphrase what he says because I can't do it as beautifully as he was able to do it, which is, you can spend your whole life working at something you don't want to do and fail at that, so you might as well try doing something that you love to do and fail at that instead. And so I've taken that under my belt here for the last couple of years and kind of run with it. And specifically, over the last couple months, I've been doing some growth and have been talking to a therapist and all that good stuff. And there was one time I was talking with her and she was like, I was like, I have always wanted to do this live performance thing. And she's like, well, why don't you do it? I'm like, well, because, you know, I have to have like 150 people show up because I'd be doing like $3 to $5 tickets. And she asked a simple question, well, why don't you just charge more money? And I was like, I don't know. And so with her kind of urging and pushing, right after that conversation, I called up this place, booked it, and kind of the rest is history at this point. So hopefully, if this goes really well, then we can start doing this a little bit more. And really, I'm most concerned about you giving me money. That is really the most important. So tonight, we have a bunch of different things planned. You are going to have to suffer through me for about 75% of it. But there's going to be comedy, jokes, obviously. There's going to be some stories that I'm going to be telling, both real life and fictional stories that I'm going to read to you. There is also going to be some video footage that's going to be played for you here as well. So not all of this is live, I guess. And then we also have live performance music that's going to happen here, too. So we have kind of a whole complement of stuff that we can enjoy here tonight. So, to start things off, why don't we start off with the first video?
Yeah.
Yay!
If you didn't hear what I said, I think I have crabs. before we go on, I was actually handed some announcements I have to read out, so bear with me here. Apparently, there is a black Jetta out front, and I'm not making this up, license plate OE69N. You're double parked. So, if anyone wants to claim that vehicle, it is out there in front. Also, another announcement. Tomatoes, not due to popular consensus, is not actually a fruit. It is a raging homosexual, though. also, one last announcement that I was given by management here. Don't go chasing waterfalls. Please, stick to the rivers and lakes that you're used to. I know that you're going to have it your way or nothing at all, but I think you're moving too fast. Just some announcements. How's everyone doing so far? Yay. So I used to believe that Santa Claus was real, which is spoiler alert, by the way, but I used to believe that Santa Claus is real, which is really weird when you think about it, that as a young kid, I really believed that there was a man living in the North Pole, elves all around him, clad in red, created by Coke, and would go around the world delivering presents all the time. And my parents encouraged me to believe this, and every adult that I went to also kind of kept up this lie. And so I think that the way that you handle that information, when you actually find out that Santa is not real, totally affects you for the rest of your life. So let me explain. I think there's really two different ways that you can really handle that information. Number one, kind of throw up that wall and be like, whatever, never believed in it anyways. Still didn't believe it because you thought it was real. Or, it's a classic narcissist. Or you are kind of the person who just your entire world crashes around you and you can't ever trust anyone again. And you're the kind of person who then grows up to attend anime conventions. Me saying that has gone to every Comic-Con for like the last 6 years. I think for me, the biggest thing is not so much that I was lied to, it was more that it's just super bad storytelling. it really bugs me. You have, if you, this was some guy going up and trying to pitch this to some studio, there's a story I'm writing about this guy who goes around the world, delivers presents, all that jazz. It's like, oh, okay. And how does he actually do this? Oh, it's magic. Magic. Okay, well, that's great, but that doesn't really explain how. Magic. All right, so where did you say that this guy lived again? Oh, it's the North Pole. Okay, great. That's fine. That's ice and snow for most of the year, but, you know, there is a huge, vast ocean that happens there because of seasons. Oh, and he has reindeer as well. Okay, that's great. You know what? I am going to be in touch with your agent, and I'm going to file this away. Trash. I also find that I'm becoming much more sympathetic to Christians as I grow older. Like, I feel really super bad for them, and let me explain to you why. This sounds like a bad setup. I find that you have this idea that Christians, if they're following the actual teachings of Christ, really feel like the entire world is their big extended family. And you and I know, based on actual families, that there's often sometimes those people that you're just kind of forced to love and be around. No matter how close or how distant, they're kind of just there all the time. But without any consequences, you would push them down a rocky cliff. You totally would. If there was absolutely no questions asked, no repercussions, you would ride their bloody corpse down that rocky hill. You react like that a little bit, but Margaret is the worst. Okay, you don't know her. The worst thing is, like, for me, I have been surrounded by so many people who I feel have this inspiring and deep level of faith, and so I know they're not like the people I see portrayed on television all the time. Specifically on cable news, they're always there to argue the other side and act in the total opposite way that I am used to seeing around me. So for me, I feel that when I see those people, I'm just filled with this deep-seated hatred. But it must be so much worse for those friends of mine who have been like, this is like Revelations, like fire and brimstone type stuff, which is my aftershave, by the way. Going for it. I find that your subconscious is the worst. For me, I've started to kind of visualize it as kind of like a small Russian mother. You do no good. You no love me. Which is my Russian. Which is about as good as the blackface I'm going to be putting on here later. That's not true. It's going to be brown-faced. So for me, it's like your subconscious is there to continually drill at you, like, you're not worthy, you're not good enough. And of course, that's not true. The more that you start to believe that sort of thing, the more that you just start to believe it. And it really is not true at all. And so I've started to have kind of a conversation with my subconscious here recently, which made for a really awkward gondola ride here the other day. And it's just me standing there being like, okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and do this thing that I always wanted to do. No. Yeah, because you're a disembodied voice and you literally mean nothing. No, you're gonna fail. Possibly, yes, that is true. That is a possibility. And I want ice cream. Well, for sure, I guess. Who does? Damn you, subconscious mind. You're the worst. Worse than Margaret and the freeze frame credits roll. And that's my new sitcom that I'll be starring in here in the fall. I'm going to point out that I don't have a very strong closer. That was it. So I guess 10 minutes of Jew jokes is what I'm going to do next year. When I, for some of you who know me personally, you know that I, for the last 6 years, have gone down to Anaheim to attend something called the VidCon, which is a conference. I realize I just made fun of people who went to anime conventions. I go to a convention that celebrates YouTube. So that's YouTube, not U2, the band, which is somehow even worse. I go to YouTube, and in there I've met so many great people that I've collaborated with and have struck up friendships with. And so I asked a couple of them to send me videos so that they could be a part of this night. And so the first person that we're going to be seeing, his name is Mitten Sony, and I saw him first because he was promoted through the Vlogbrothers channel. If you know anything about YouTube, that's run by Hank and John Green. John Green you might be more familiar with because he wrote The Fault in Our Stars, which became a movie last year, and has become like super, super popular. He promoted this channel that I started watching, and when I first went, or I think my third or fourth VidCon was there, I saw Mitten from across the way. I was like, oh, cool, I know that guy. And I was like, hey, I really like your videos. And basically, he would not leave me alone since that. He just really glommed on to me. So this is a video that he sent me called Fireworks or Handguns. That's what it's called. We can also advance that slide so we don't see Mitten there for the rest of the show. I forgot, I was given some more announcements. Totally true announcements. The black Jetta that we talked about before is being towed, right? Scientists have just discovered what the deal is with airplane food. They didn't tell me what it is, they just said that they discovered it. By law of averages, one of you here has pictured me naked, and now you all have. You're welcome, perverts. So next up, I'm going to invite somebody who I have literally known for dozens and dozens of days. Mr. Ralph Gonzalez is going to be doing some stand-up here for us.
I will do my best. Okay. I'm not gonna lie, this is a little bit weird for me because I'm on stage with a microphone and I'm not doing karaoke, so bear with me for now. So I'm gonna give you guys a little bit of a background of who I am. So as Kyle has introduced me, I am Ralph Gonzalez, and I was born in the Philippines and moved to Canada in 96. And you know what? I'm gonna be honest with you guys, I was not a pretty baby. I was not gonna lie, like, I look like an alien. See this forehead of mine? I use a hat to disguise it. It's enormous. I don't have a receding hairline. It's just my forehead. I grew into this. Like, this actually stuck out that much when I was a kid. So, you know what? Just because my mother took the time and effort to push me out, I do thank her vagina almost every day. Honestly, I go down there and I say, thank you. Look at me. And then she slaps in my face and says, get the fuck out of there. So, and just because I was not a pretty baby, I'm happy that my parents were realistic with me at such a young age. Because I was a pageant child. Yes, not many of you know this, but I was a pageant child. And my parents didn't enter me in anything like, I have the cutest baby, or my baby's this small. No, my parents entered me in a very, I'd say racist pageant. In the Philippines, they entered me in one that's called, Does Your Child Look Chinese? No, I'm serious on this one. They did enter me in a Chinese, like, Does Your Child Look Chinese beauty pageant. And I won. I did, and I had a partner with me, and I saw the photos. They are incredibly racist. I actually still have the little hat they gave me. It, honestly, no doubt about it, it's like almost like a combination yarmulke with like a ponytail combined. And then you have me wearing this like almost traditional Chinese garb. So it's a little bit racy and kind of fucked up. And I still can't believe they did this. When you win, they have you drive around the town in a rickshaw, waving at people, wearing a sash saying Mr. China, and with the backboard saying, Mr. Winner China. That's kind of fucked up, just a bit. And after that wonderful debacle, my parents moved to Canada here. And I gotta say, growing up in Canada, it was a little bit different. Because, well, I'll give you guys some backstory here. Being Filipino, during the Philippines, or back in the Philippines, the Spaniards came over and literally mated with all the women. No lie. That's why you'll find many Filipinos with Spanish last names. Hence, Gonzalez, Gonzalez, Garcia, Hernandez. And so growing up in Canada with Spanish friends, my mom, we would offer things to them such as puto. And for those of you who know Spanish, puto means prostitute or whore. In Tagalog, that means rice cake. So during my birthday, we would have our Hispanic friends over, and my mom would say, oh, hello, would you like some puto? And I'm letting you know right now, puto is served with a little bit of cheese on top. So when you're a Spanish kid and someone offers you with some, you know, puto with a little bit of cheese on top, do you take it? No, because that's a venereal disease. And I gotta say, I'm really happy that my parents raised me the way they did, because they knew how to save frugally. Well, I don't know how to combine the two words, but they saved well. So, growing up, we used to be able to pack 8 people in a 4-seater car. And it was really sketchy when we actually went to our trip to Mexico. With the last name Gonzalez and Canadian passports going into Mexico and then coming out, I would be suspicious. Just because I was 16 at the time, I was near, like, this was a van, and I was in the trunk, and then I have 2 people in the front with my younger cousins in the back, and then my parents in the front of the car. So there's all of us, and there's 2 people in the trunk with me. So that was a bit sketchy. I wouldn't trust myself, you know? I wouldn't trust if Border Patrol just came and says, so, let's see these passports. Canadian. Gonzalez? Excuse me, sir. How many people are in your vehicle? 8 Stay here.
We got some immigrants trying to get in. We need to call Border Patrol cops.
So that was that gig, but I guess I didn't get that much of a laugh. Okay, I'll go to my next one. So, you know what, Kyle? I'm in a similar boat with you about Santa Claus. You can't be Filipino and believe in Santa Claus, because every Filipino, like Santa Claus, is brown. And the other side's white. And you know what? I'm glad that Santa Claus is white, because, you know, Santa Claus comes into your house and leaves gifts. If Santa Claus was any other color and he broke into your house, not many people would enjoy him. And you know what? My parents are reaching that age now, where the only way that they can communicate with each other, or even with me, is by sounds. So whenever my dad needed to take a seat, he'd go, what? And I'd be like, yeah, dad? that's my cue to turn on the TV. And then my mom, on the other hand, ooh, this is a big one. Whenever she sees me, and she sees me do things that she doesn't approve, just like stand-up comedy, she goes like this. And so a conversation between my mom and dad about me would be, oh man, family dinners are the best for that reason. All I do is just sit there with my iPod in front of me and just watching some Netflix, because I don't want to know what's going on between my mom and dad. My brother, on the other hand, he's the golden child. He's the one that was more into the math, more into the sciences, and now he actually works for an oil and gas company and makes more money than both of them combined. And my mom loves talking about my brother. He's like, oh yeah, he's doing good. He's the guy that they go to know where it's safe to drill. How about your other son? Huh. Elf. He just tells jokes for a living. He doesn't do much. It's almost like kind of a half burden, yet half kind of joy in her voice. Like, he's funny. He's a funny man. But I think his jokes are kind of racist. It's true. I actually tested my set on my parents, and the only words they said to me were, really, that's racist. Why did you do this? Do you think you're funny talking about Filipinos like this? I'm like, Mom, I'm Filipino. This is okay. It's okay. Do you really think it's okay? Hi, Mara. The puto joke. You're talking about that? That was an accident. How was I supposed to know Moses was Spanish? You look Filipino. And I'm not gonna lie, my parents, I love them. And on the similar topic of the frugalness list, my parents entered me in an all-Chinese driving school. No joke. It's near Center Street. It's called the International Driving School. And it's run by a guy named Han Xiaofeng. And the entire class was all Chinese. And somehow I was able to blend in, and halfway through the lesson, because I was kind of the quiet, shy kid who didn't want to stand out at a driving school, just sat there as the guy spoke Chinese to me for the first half. It finally came to the point where, okay, let's all introduce each other. Who's here? And then this is all in Chinese. By the way, I have no idea what's going on. And I'm like, excuse me. I'm Ralph. I'm Filipino. And the guy looks at me like this. Hiya! Why the fuck did you not tell me earlier? And that's when I'm like, I'm sorry. And I started breaking down and crying in front of him. Not gonna lie, that's not how you show dominance. It was almost like a prison show there. Well, let's see here what else I got here. I'm not too sure. And, yeah, that's all.
So I want to do about 5 minutes of immigrant jokes about my parents now. They come from central Alberta. Do you know about the United States?
Yeah.
Yeah, you've heard about that before? Yeah. So I don't know if you know about this, but in 18 months, they're going to be electing another president down there. And right now, Mr. Donald Trump is running for president. Which is so great on so many levels, because it's very indicative of their thing that they like to do. What I want to do is, he did a speech a few weeks ago that was very widely panned. And what I've done is I have cut out actual sentences that he said and kind of stitched them together into a smaller version of that speech. I also want to reiterate that this is exact quotes from his speech, and I'm not making up a single one of these. So you guys pretend that I'm Donald Trump.
Thanks for your hair.
Yeah, I know. They can't get jobs because there are no jobs, because China has our jobs and Mexico has our jobs. Our enemies are getting stronger and stronger by the day, and we, as a country, are getting weaker. Even our nuclear arsenal doesn't work. We have a disaster called the big lie, Obamacare. You have to get hit by a tractor, literally a tractor. I have so many websites, I have them all over the place. I hire people, they do a website, it costs me $3. They're killing us. But you don't hear that from anyone else. You don't hear that from anybody else. Obama's going to be out playing golf. He might be even on one of my courses. I would invite him. I have the best courses in the world. I have to tell you, I have lobbyists that can produce anything for me. They're great. I'll bring back our jobs from China, from Mexico, from Japan, from so many places. I'll bring back our jobs, and I'll bring back our money. Free trade can be wonderful if you have smart people, but we have people that are stupid. Hey, I'm not saying they're stupid. I like China. I just sold an apartment for $15 million to somebody from China. Am I supposed to dislike them? And by the way, I'm not even saying that to brag. That's the kind of mindset, that's the kind of thinking that you need for this country. I love the Saudis. Many of them are in this building. They make $1 billion a day. I think I'm a nice person. Does my family like me? I think so. Look at my family. So a large accounting firm and my accountants have been working for months because I'm big and complex, and they put together a statement, a financial statement. I don't need to brag. I don't have to, believe it or not. I would build a great wall. And nobody builds walls better than me, believe me. And I'll build them very inexpensively. I will build a great, great wall on our southern border, and I will have Mexico pay for that wall. And I promise, I will never be in a bicycle race. That I can tell you. That is Donald Trump's speech. So in this part of the evening, I actually did have someone lined up to also come up and tell some jokes, and they had to bail at the very last second. So here, just to fill some time, I'm going to awkwardly stare at you for 5 minutes.
Getting aroused. I'm already there.
So that was more awkward than I anticipated it being. Let's do this. Maybe we can do some questions from the audience here instead. Oh, Elise, I think you have a question.
I do.
Yeah, totally spontaneous.
Why are you so handsome?
Oh my goodness. I mean, I get asked this quite a lot. You know, it's a regimen of running, drinking water, and ritual human sacrifice. It's not a big thing. You draw a few pentagrams, pick up some goats, slice their necks. I mean, it's not a big, big deal. Capture a few homeless guys. The biggest deal is to try and not have anyone else hear them scream. Chloroform does the trick. That's how I stay so handsome here. Daniel, I think you have a question.
I love Charlie Chaplin. He's probably my favorite. He's in this one movie called City Lights, where... Oh, the question, yeah.
Yeah.
Are you going to do this again? Like, come here?
Oh, God, no. Okay. We'll have to see. At the end of the night, if people have actually enjoyed their time here, then possibly. Or I will be drinking alone at Molly Malone's next door, which is most Wednesday nights anyway, so I guess that won't be a big difference. We just have time for one more. Oh, Justin, you have a question back there.
Yeah, I heard you planted these questions in the audience. Is that true?
Absolutely not. This is all spontaneous, and I love improv and spur of the seat moment, so totally spur of the moment. Next thing, we're going to do a video here again next, and I'm going to tell you right now, this is really for my benefit more than it is for yours. Oh, I say that. So if you saw the poster that was designed out there, by the way, sign posters, $2 each, you can pick up the copy here as you leave, was designed by a guy named Chris Taniguchi, who again I met while I was down at VidCon. Him and his twin brother run a channel called The Playgrounders, and they are going to be very soon doing a Kickstarter campaign to fund their first album. What they sent me was the behind the scenes of that video, which has actually not been posted yet. So this is kind of like their outtakes, which is very, I don't know, quintessential Taniguchi Brothers. So I'm probably going to find it way more funny than any of you is. So enjoy this. I bet you can guess what's coming up next. They gave me some more announcements to read out. I'm sorry to keep doing this. That little black Jetta that's outside. It's been caught in the turf war. It is now currently on fire. So again, license plate, always 69ing, out there, on fire. Second announcement, it's always good to remember that all of your insecurities are true and you'll never feel real happiness. And lastly, it rubs the lotion on its skin or else it gets the hose again. That's just a bit of foreplay I enjoy. So, some of you may not know this, but in my free time, I do like to fancy myself a writer. And so I've been getting way better at actually sharing those stories here in recent years, but I would like to read one of them to you now. And so this is a fictional story that I created here last year. I'm a big fan of fairy tales, and I'm not just talking about Friday nights. I'm a big fan of fairy tales ever since I was a little kid. It's just been fascinating me, like the construction of them, how they were collected in by the Brothers Grimm and the French guy who I'm forgetting right now. But since that time, I've tried to emulate that every so often. And so I did this exercise last year where I tried to write my own fairy tales. And this was a product of one of them, which is not exactly a fairy tale as it turns out, but it was my kick at the can. This is titled, there seems to be an ongoing theme here tonight, and I didn't even plan it this way. This is called Santa Rides Again. So it is a story about Santa. So not very long ago, at the North Pole, two figures could be seen trudging over the hard-packed snow. One was tall in a reddish ermine fur coat with a white fringe. He had a similar-looking cap on his head and black boots lined with seal fur on his feet. This was Santa Claus. Beside him was a man half his height. He wore strange shoes that tapered to a fine point and curled back towards him. He resembled Santa in appearance, but not in stature. He was clean-shaven. He had many years ago attempted to grow a beard that would match the luxurious majesty of Santa's beard, but he had only managed to grow a patchy mess of facial hair. This was Sam, Santa's longtime friend and an elf. It was frigid. It was not currently snowing, which was a small miracle, but being outside for any length of time was uncomfortable. Overhead, the northern lights illuminated the night sky in brilliant shades of emerald and orange. Each breath Santa expelled sent plumes of white mist into the air. Normally, he would have stopped to admire the strange beauty of it all, but there was no time. Santa was responsible for all the good children of the world getting presents on Christmas morning. Well, at least that had been the original idea. Santa's operation was not quite as extensive as the Hollywood spin would lead most people to believe. Santa cursed, "It's that damn soda company," he complained inwardly. The soda company was a favorite target of Santa's anger. At least once a month, he would go on a tirade about how they had only ruined drinking water around the world and also assassinated his character by presenting an image of Santa that was impossible to live up to and mostly wrong. "Damn them," he said out loud. "What's that?" asked Sam. "I don't deliver presents to every girl and boy each year. I mean, how would that even be possible? I have many helpers." "You're thinking about the soda company again, aren't you? Forget about it. You know that Martha hates when you work yourself up." Martha, Santa's wife, had banned any talk of the sugar water in her presence. She had put up with it for far too long. "But I mean, how crazy does one have to believe in such far-fetched, fantastical ideas that bend the rules of physics?" Santa sighed. "Now let's go over the plans for the flying reindeer. Can we please do that inside the stable? As warm as these pointy shoes are, my toes are going numb." They walked in silence the rest of the way. All their energies were spent willing their bodies to stay warm. Once inside the stable, they both stamped their feet to knock off any excess snow that may have accumulated. The stables were quite warm, both in temperature and in atmosphere. A wood stove crackled on the opposite side of the building. Its glow was hypnotic and welcoming.
The building housed 8 individual pins, 4 on each side, separated by a hallway in the middle. All right, Sam, are they going to be ready? Well, tough to say, Santa, it's tough to say. I mean, Prancer's still recovering from that bout of foot rot. Santa sighed. Well, with downcast eyes and a weary voice, he asked, Sam, have you thought of maybe just giving up this whole Christmas thing? Sam was shocked. No, never. How could you say such a thing out loud? Sam had clutched his chest over dramatically. I'm not needed anymore. I spent so much time developing my list each year, and then what happens? The parents of the naughty kids get their children presents anyway. Worse, they forge my name on them. They have their children put out cookies and milk, and then eat them when their children go to bed. They are psychologically manipulating and lying to their kids, and worse, raising successive generations of narcissistic assholes. Santa, Sam exclaimed. He then dropped his pitch as if trying to keep a secret. Watch your language around the reindeer. You know how sensitive they are to it. Indeed, Blitzen had begun whimpering pathetically in his pen. Santa walked over to him and scratched the reindeer behind the ears. I'm sorry, old friend. Santa's just in one of his moods. I can't imagine ever canceling Christmas, moaned Sam. Christmas can never be canceled, was Santa's ominous reply. That's the long and short of it. If our enterprise ever stopped delivering gifts, there would be a great shock one year, and then it would be forgotten by the next. Parents would go out of their way and buy gifts for their children instead of trying to explain how magic disappeared to a 3-year-old doe-eyed dummy. Santa stroked his beard. Then a glimmer of light flashed in his eyes. He turned towards the elfin friend. I'm going out this year, Sam. To deliver? Do you think that's wise? No idea, but I need to have my faith restored. Normally, Santa had his elves travel to the different geographical areas to deliver presents. It was about as many as one would think. 2 could deliver to the UK, 12 or 13 to Canada. The United States was where the bulk of the staff had to go, with 55 elves delivering. There were various other spots around the globe where the remaining 5 elves could deliver to. However, Santa was proud that the entirety of Christmas could be done with less than 100 staff. Plus, as Santa so often reminded them, they were paid and had benefits. Not everything was rosy, truth be told, as there had recently been talk of an elf union being formed, but that's a story for another time. I could take one of the easier legs, Santa continued, maybe Western Canada or Northern Ireland. There's a football game on Christmas Eve, said Sam. Oh, well, then not Ireland. So Canada should be just fine. Oh, Sam, I think I may be getting my twinkle back. If you were any other person, that would have me concerned, said Sam. Santa scratched Blitzen under the chin. This is going to be a great Christmas. Over the next 2 weeks, Santa made arrangements. It had been so long since he had gone out to deliver that he needed to be refitted with the proper garments. He recertified and took all the proper tests. This was more of a formality than an actual evaluation. Santa had made it clear that he would be going regardless of the results. Dandelion the elf was 5 months away from retirement. He could not afford to take the risk. Santa passed with flying colors. Soon it was Christmas Eve and Santa was ready to head out. Martha was understandably worried. What if you crash into the ocean? Honestly, at your age, you shouldn't be up so high. You could easily fall out of that sleigh. I'll be strapped in. I'm not 8,000 years old. I'm only 4,000. Spring chickens consider me just hatched. I'll be fine, Martha. They embraced. Santa kissed her on the forehead. Well, I baked you some of my cookies that you can eat along the way. Real cookies. You know how your tummy reacts to that corn syrup. Martha handed over a fairly large package wrapped in tinfoil. I'll only be gone a few hours, Martha. Then share some with Sam. Sam would be in the co-pilot seat for the entire night. This had been stipulated by Martha, and Sam was none too happy about it. I suppose it is just peachy if I plummet to my doom then. Great, tell me again why I'm being forced out of retirement too, complained the elf. Eat this, Santa replied, throwing the package of cookies at Sam. Santa would be one of the first teams going out. Since the advent of standardized time, there were waves of teams instead of the entire fleet taking off at once. Santa surveyed the scene. He felt a twinge of pride. This entire operation was something that he had created from scratch. Being a simple northern elf with a basic upbringing meant that he had been told that he would amount to little more than a pile of ice shavings. In fact, It was commonly believed that he would work the most of his life in the ice shaving's mine. His father had worked there, and so had his grandfather. Nobody would have guessed that the son of an icicle miner would grow up to be a revered cultural icon, factory owner, job creator, reindeer breeder, and magical guru. Santa tried not to think that stuff about that stuff too often, as it made him recall his mom and dad, long since passed. In fact, most of the Northern Elves were gone, suffering catastrophic tragedy due to the terrible events of the North Pole War, which had been waged many years previous. A tear was forming in the corner of Santa's eye. He wiped it away and pushed the melancholy thoughts from his mind. Santa hardly missed any of the so-called good old days. What he did miss was the feeling of takeoff. The mystery and magic of reindeer flight had a long and somewhat dubious history. Some short-sighted inbreeding had almost eliminated the skill from the herds of the Arctic. The recessive gene still showed up in the most unique of animals. Santa's employees worked diligently to find and capture such specimens. Great care was taken to raise, house, and train the animals. Flight plans were pored over so that nothing would interfere with deliveries. Santa never wanted to relive the terror of watching a 450-pound male reindeer crash through the front window of a 747, which was on its way to Iceland one Christmas. The cover-up had really not been worth it. Santa had been on planes before. They were nice enough, but the feeling of the wind in his beard was incomparable. He even enjoyed the icicles that formed in his eyebrows, caused by the plumes of steam generated by the dedicated beasts lashed to the sleigh in front of them. Sam had always been right there by his side. Sam was ready to take the reins if something were to go wrong, which it rarely ever did. The field marshal waved a flag to signal to get ready. Santa grasped the reins, wiped a bead of sweat from his brow, and gave a nod to the man with the flag. The field marshal sliced the flag through the air, and Santa whipped the leather straps. The agile reindeer jumped. They trotted at first, but soon broke into a gallop. The sleigh gained speed over a few hundred meters. Then, moving like a flock of birds, the reindeer team jumped in unison and lifted the sleigh with them. Their hooves gripped the air as if it were snow. Some unseen tactile presence carried them higher and higher into the atmosphere. The other sleigh team circled with Santa's sleigh. From the ground, it looked like some bizarre tornado as the reindeer continued circling higher. Eventually, they were high enough to avoid any airplane flight paths, and with some extra magic made it so that they could not be seen by an anonymous set of eyes. The different teams broke off in different directions, and soon Santa and Sam were by themselves. The wind vibrated against the eardrums, and the brazen beasts in front of them ululated strongly. Sam, looking very cross, buried himself under a half dozen knitted quilts that Martha had given him as successive Christmas gifts. Santa, with the first icicle beginning to form in his eyebrows, had the largest smile on his face he had had in a long time. It took only a couple of hours to arrive in Vancouver. Santa had always enjoyed the time on the west coast of Canada. Santa thought that this was perhaps because of the friendly people and the dynamic art scene. It was also because of the pot, but he did not let Martha know that. Things went according to plan. Santa was able to use his temporal shifting device in order to deliver to multiple houses at once. Santa had once tried to explain to Sam how such a device worked, and why it was of such importance to him, but it had fallen on bored ears, and really, who truly wants to know how the magic happens? People marvel at the abracadabra and rarely care about the footnotes. They were still in the greater Vancouver area, the city of Richmond in particular, when they came upon an unassuming house. Nothing about it was particularly unique. It was gray, and it was two stories, and it existed. Santa was in the living room, removing the presents from his sack. Behind him, he heard a muffled whimper. When he turned to investigate, he came upon a small girl in a pink onesie. Her hair was in pigtails that stuck out at 90 degrees from her head. A tear rolled down her cheek. "What troubles you, little one?" Santa asked in his best and most rehearsed, caring and gravelly grandfather voice. "I don't want what you're giving me," sniffed the little girl. Santa was taken aback. "Why not?" he asked. "I need more," was her reply. Santa looked sideways at Sam. The elf knew what was coming and reached into his back pocket to produce a well-worn bit of parchment. He began scanning it. "Excuse me," Santa trailed off. "Cindy," Sam offered. "Cindy, excuse me while I talk with my elf friend." Santa guided Sam over to the corner and spoke in hushed tones. "What does the list say?" "Keep your furs on. I'm looking at it, aren't I?" Santa snatched it from Sam's hand and began frantically scanning and cross-checking the multiple columns on the list. I keep telling you, we should upgrade to some kind of electronic solution, said Sam. At least something with search capabilities. You look ridiculous right now. Hush, said Santa. He pulled his glasses to the end of his nose and continued to scan the parchment in his hands. Ah, here it is. I knew I would find it, Santa proclaimed triumphantly. Then, as an aside, also, the day we go electronic is the day I begin eating venison. Santa returned to the list and furrowed his brow. Huh. Well, that's curious. What is? Asked Sam. Cindy is for sure on the nice list. I don't understand. She obviously should be on the naughty list. Santa? Cindy had edged her way over to the corner. What are you doing? I often ask that myself, said Sam. Santa cleared his throat. I'm confused, little one. I trust the list above all things, and it says you are nice. But you also seem full of greed to ask for more than you already have so much. Ephraim doesn't, was her reply. Ephraim. Santa returned to the list. Who is Ephraim? He lives outside. He lives outside, but it's so cold tonight. You are surely a Sherlock among us Watsons, Santa, Sam said under his breath. If either Santa or Cindy heard, they made no indication. Yes, was Cindy's reply. He lives outside, under the bridge. His mommy lives with him. I like him. He's nice. Mommy and Daddy tell me not to talk with him, though. He's kind of dirty. You'd like to take some of these presents and give them to him? Yeah, I bet he'd like them. I have no doubt, was Santa's reply. Cindy, would you do me a favor? Okay. Go back upstairs. I'll make sure that Ephraim is looked after. Okay, Cindy ran upstairs. She would not remember her meeting with Santa. Sam was already trailing up the stairs after her to make sure that a special smelling salt was administered to Cindy. It would include a slight amount of memory loss. Essentially, Santa occasionally drugs children, and we're just all going to have to deal with that. When Sam returned downstairs, Santa was despondent. What am I going to do, Sam? Nothing. She's not going to remember anything. Maybe some fuzzy half-memories, but nothing concrete. You know we can't go and deliver to the homeless. It's different this time somehow. No, it's not, asserted Sam. We are the same people. Cindy is no different than any other girl you've met in the past. We do not start delivering presents to street people. It was true. There had been a long-standing rule that presents needed to be delivered within homes. It promoted family values and Christmas spirit. Plus, there was the issue that the homeless were, well, homeless. They moved about and did not stay in one spot for too long. There was no definitive way to ensure that they would be where they needed to be on Christmas morning. I feel bad, Sam. Probably those cookies Martha made. I keep telling you, you're probably lactose intolerant. You should really ask the next time you see the doctor. No, but the rule about this Ephraim. Bah. We deliver to a few more houses and you won't even be able to remember the name. Santa made up his mind. We are going to go and see him. Well, all right, Sam threw up his hands exasperately, but you're going to pay me overtime, whether you like it or not. With multiple bridges nearby, it was on the third pick in which the odd pair stumbled upon a woman and a young boy sleeping under a large discarded piece of cardboard. Tendrils of mist wafted upwards from the pair as they gently snored through the cold. Go nudge them awake, said Santa. Go nudge them awake. This is all your idea. Santa gave a look that was not to be debated with. Fine, I get the rest of the cookies, Sam rumbled. Sam crept forward and gently nudged the small boy. The boy's eyes fluttered open and terror overtook him. Sam held a finger up to his own lips to signal not to scream or yell. The boy screamed and yelled. All at once, the quiet morning was filled with squawks and shrieks. The mother had woken and was swinging at Sam. Sam expertly ducked, and Santa had to step in to try and tear the two parties apart. Eventually, they were able to calm down. The mother and son stared at the strangers warily. Santa spoke first. We would like to speak with Ephraim. What about? Your perfect friend almost touched my son. It was a nudge, protested Sam. Soon, there was another calamity as shouts and epithets were tossed about from both sides. It took another few minutes to calm them down again. I know this may be hard to believe, but I am Santa Claus. Santa had barely gotten through saying the entire name before the woman said, dude, you are higher than I am. That's saying something. Lady, if I were you, I wouldn't say anything again, Sam warned. There was a pause. Because you're stupid. That may have not been clear. The woman tried swinging again at the elf, but missed. I can prove that I am. What's your name? What's it to you? I can tell what I got you for Christmas on a certain year? Sure you can. Tell me what I got for Christmas when I was 5 years old. Very well, said Santa. What is your name and where were you born? I have to admit that this isn't a very good trick so far. My name is Stephanie Bolger, born in 1975. Sam handed another thicker piece of rolled up parchment to Santa. Santa unfurled it and began frantically searching it. A couple of minutes passed by until Santa exclaimed, ah, found it. Stephanie Bolger, on the Christmas when you were 5, you received from me. Santa ran his finger along the parchment, his eyes dropped, his voice quavered. Nothing. You received nothing from me. Snow was beginning to fall. The world felt quiet and asleep, save for the 4 people assembled under the bridge. Sam had turned away, visibly upset. A tear rolled down Stephanie's cheek. What do you want to ask Ephraim? With a bit of trepidation, Santa walked forward and knelt down beside the child. Ephraim, do you know a little girl by the name of Cindy? Ephraim nodded his head. She's a sweet girl, and she asked me for more presents for herself so that she could give them to you. Would you like that? Ephraim shook his head. Santa heard Sam's exasperated sigh behind him. Why not, child? Asked Santa. Ephraim's reply came out in a whisper. I want mommy to be better first. Santa glanced up. Stephanie looked shocked. I don't have anything wrong with me, said Stephanie. By the empty bottles and cans that littered their surroundings, Santa felt she may not be the best judge of what was wrong or not. Santa left that unsaid. I understand, little one, said Santa. Unfortunately, there are things I just cannot do. Sam, bring me my sack. Sam brought it over. Santa reached inside. He pulled out a teddy bear. I can give you this. Wish to him, and hopefully someone out there will answer your prayers. Ephraim shook his head. I had a bear, he continued, still in whisper. He did nothing. I threw him in the river. Santa awkwardly continued to hold the bear as an offering to the boy, and the boy would not take it. Santa was forced to put it back into his sack. Santa and Sam returned to the sleigh. Feel better? Asked Sam. Not at all, said Santa somberly. Not at all. Thank you. All right. So, we're going to take a look at the last video here, and this is from someone who sent it to me who I met on my very first day of the job I currently am. He's the very first person I met, and he does a lot of piano bar playing here in the city. So his name is Craig Learmont, and he sent in a video of what he would normally do on a typical day at Aussie Rules. So we'll do that.
Hey, welcome everybody. This is a special presentation for my friend Kyle. I really wanted to be there with you, but I couldn't. So I'm just doing a recording of what I call my Attention Deficit Disorder Medley. So I hope you like it. Check it out. Here it is. Just a small town girl, living in a lonely world. She took the midnight train going anywhere. My baby takes the morning train. She works from... Sorry about that. Sitting in a smoky room. Smoking in the boardroom. Teacher, don't you fill me up with your rules. Cause everybody knows that smoking and allowed it. Yeah. go, do you see the light? Take me home tonight. Listen, honey, just like Ronnie said, oh, oh, be my little. Oh, baby, baby, I shouldn't have let you go. Never gonna give you up, never gonna let you down, never gonna run around and hurt you, never gonna make you cry, never gonna say goodbye. Na, na, na. Disorder medley. Oh, look, there's a bird.
All right, how are we doing so far tonight? Good. We're still paying attention. We are somehow going like super over time with what we're doing. So, without further ado, then. I have some more announcements. True announcements. The Black Jetta, that's outside. Your hubcaps are double parked. There will be no more fake announcements. I feel pretty. Oh, so pretty. I feel pretty and witty and bright, and I pity any girl who isn't me tonight. Real announcements from management. Next up, I'm going to introduce you to someone who I've literally known for dozens and dozens of minutes. Joel Camps, down here, over there, there he is, a local musician, and he's going to come up and play a few songs here for us.
Well, thanks for having me. This has been a real pleasure to be getting to listen to you tell stories and enjoy some jokes. And everything so far has been pretty cool. I think this should happen in Calgary more often. Can everybody hear me? Is this crispy? Yeah. Crispy-ish? With a little bit of reverb, so it feels like space back there. All right. Unfortunately, I really write pretty depressing music sometimes, so I don't know, that story was really kind of beautiful and sad and really, really awesome. I quite enjoyed it. So, what am I going to do here? I'm going to do a bit of a darker song first. I'm going to try and do 3 songs, if that's okay. I have 15 minutes, so I'll stop talking. ADHD and attentive, it is quite bad. It's the evil cousin, or the evil step-sibling of ADD, if you've... Well, yeah. Great. Okay. This is called Old Soul. And I do a lot of storytelling when I play music regularly, but not right now. There's no easy way to actually fix the wrong capo. In the middle of the song, so there we go. When I walk alone, I think I am the better man. 'Cause when I come back home, my past catches up again. So I spend an estate on dusty gravel roads. Funeral blood images have been shed, and I still got nothing to show. I'm a young man with an old man's soul. I'm a young man with an old man's soul. I've escaped in the darkest parts of life. I've done things I wish I could cut from the back of my mind. No matter what kind of comforts I seek to find, I could never get enough. I'm a factory of lust. No, I'm never satisfied. I'm a young man with an old man's soul. I'm a young man with an old man's soul. Friends along the way to entry drugs. I've lost friends along the way in the name of some so-called love. We're always claiming to know something from beyond, using the truth as a word to justify the hurt we're soon getting we deserve. I'm a young man with an old still hear everything all right? Yes? All right. Perfect. So I had the pleasure of traveling to Europe just this past winter with my wife. We went there for 4 months backpacking, playing house concerts, and doing all sorts of fun stuff there. This next one's called Amsterdam, so it's, well, some of you made the connection very quickly. That's awesome. I won a free beer for a year one time for this song from Big Rock. It was a lovely year. Then the year ended and I was sad, but my body was happy. So. The song's about a guy who's having a shower in the sink in a train station. Anyone here ever done that before? Truck stops count, this is Alberta. Okay, here we go. can't forget how far I've come. Cause life, it ain't no game. Sometimes it's cold and hard and rough. And I've seen my share of pain. And I've caused my share of tears. But the hurt that hides behind these eyes is the very thing I fear. Now I do not live the same. I cannot recognize behind the mask of shame and pain. My greenish downcast, cloudy bloodshot eyes. My greenish downcast, cloudy bloodshot eyes. My greenish dark has cloudy bloodshot eyes. All right, and one more to go. So I normally do a lot of storytelling when I play. House concerts are my favorite, and this feels like a nice, massive living room with like tons of mini couches. Lots of them. This one's called From the Start, and it feels like a really good vibe here. So this must be a really cool, interconnected group of friends, I think. And this song kind of is about that. I guess we're sort of going on a journey in these songs, I suppose. So there's the dark chapter, there's sort of this still dark time, reflective time, and this song is about returning to a place where you feel kind of that sense of home, whether that's with your family or friends or a different kind of community altogether. But when I wrote this song, I pictured a small town in Alberta, which is not where most people would necessarily associate some of those things with, if you're from the city, I suppose. But picture a small town called Lacombe. All right. You've obviously never been there then. I'm just kidding. It's an interesting town. But my dad grew up there as a young boy, west of the city, on a little farm, and he started life there because both of my grandfathers came from the Netherlands to Canada as young men to start lives over here. That's why I got the weird spelling in my name, J-O-A-L. So I'm named after both grandfathers, John Coyne and Albert Camps. Yeah, these guys are in the middle of the smart ones here. That was quick.
Ow!
Ow! All right. Anyways, Albert Camps started out life in Saskatchewan. In the dirty 30s, they basically lost everything. So that sucked. And he was sitting in town one day, and this wagon came into town with some food, and it was relief food. And he lined up with all the other folks, and eventually it was his turn at the front of the line. And he got up there, and he put his hands out, and this gentleman handed him this head of lettuce. Now, he said this head of lettuce was about, you know, this big, and Albert Camps was always one to be a pretty straight shooter. Now, John Coyman, this is my mother's father, he was more known for, you know, he always said, it doesn't have to be true, it just has to be a good story. But Albert Camps was a pretty truthful guy. So this must have been quite the head of lettuce. And he said, sir, where on earth did this, where was this grown? Where did this come from? And the gentleman said, well, this came from Alberta. That's the province next to here. And he said, well, where in Alberta? And he said, well, this was grown near a place called Lacombe. So Albert Camps said, all right, family, pack up. We got nothing here. We're going to Alberta. So he started life out there picking rocks out of a farmer's field with his bare hand. That was his job. Pretty crazy. Then he worked and worked and worked and saved up enough money to buy a shovel, which slightly sped up that process and kept shoveling rocks out of fields. And eventually he saved up enough money to buy a small plot of land off the farmer and took over the whole farm and had a very successful kind of dairy, dairy operation out there. And now if you head west out of Lacombe on Highway 12, you'll see Camps, 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 Camps. It's pretty cool. So right now we are a three-generation farm family of the year in Alberta, and we're going for a fourth because my little cousin is going to try and take over the farm, so it's pretty cool. Anyways, I wrote this song picturing someone going back to a place where they feel like home after a dark night of the soul or a dark century, or not century, a dark decade of the soul. It's called From the Start. You can feel free to sing along if you'd like. I used to scream in a hardcore band, so I fell in love with Danny vocals. Now I play pansy music, but I'm okay with it. I think it's just as passionate. I could do bad jokes all day, but alright, here we go. This is called From the Start. You get to do this stuff full time because there's definitely a good calling here, I think. You as well. I hope you get to do comedy full time because it's awesome. I'm not the big deal. Yes, yes, very good. I do have some CDs for sale tonight, and normally my wife would be here to play a couple songs with me, so unfortunately I get to miss the joy of melodica and harmonies and things, but you can always hear us again. Anyways, we have CDs for sale tonight. I have three of them. I'm doing a deal, all three for 30. Sojourner on the far right is the first full-length album we put out. Craig Learmont played on that album. And it actually won a Western Canadian Music Award. All right. The Ready P was also recorded at Craig's place, actually, out in Three Hills, which is so weird. Super cool. He may have done some work on that one. And then the brand new album we just released is called Heads is East, Tails is West. I have the really bad hair. What are you doing there? We just got back from our tour, and we just found out that has been nominated for another Western Canadian Music Award, so we're feeling pretty pumped about that. Woo! And my lovely wife, Lauren, makes some beautiful handcrafted, handmade, and repurposed jewelry, so feel free to come pick at that. She's having launch parties this weekend, and Friday is open. If anyone is interested, please grab cards. There's cards up front. Just say hi, I'm lonely, okay?
Right. Well, that is the end of our show here then. We have to be out of here in 17 minutes. Oh my god. Turf war. Which means that we are at the part of the show where we need to thank some people. But first of all, I would like to give a huge thank you to everyone who came out here tonight. If you saw me at work today, I was a big bundle of nerves. I really thought that maybe no one was going to show up here tonight. So this is nice that so many of you did come out. Because I organized it, though, really, the person we should all be thanking is me. Run down the rest of the people here. Daniel Neville Jones for helping me lug all this stuff around here. Kevin Anderson for going and getting some good AA batteries for me at the last moment. Ralph Gonzalez for coming and helping me out here live. In those film segments, in the first one, that was Ryan Irving, who was sitting next to me on the bench. He's the actor. Charles Hamilton was the director for that. And Sean Garrett, you could see in the background in one scene. Chris Taniguchi designed the poster. Him and his brother, Nick Taniguchi, were in that one video. Mitten Sony also sent in Craig Laramont, Joel Camps, and we have Logan that was up there at the projector. So we can thank everyone here at the Plaza for letting me do this in the first place. The therapist I was talking about, Dorothy Baglioni, that is who I need to thank, because without her encouragement, this would never have happened in the first place. And also for the ancient monks who made beer, because that's what I'm going to go and enjoy here in a few minutes. Yeah. Hopefully you did enjoy yourself. I don't know if this was worth the $12 to you or not, but hopefully if you can tell other people, then we can do this again sometime, perhaps in October. Perfect. Thank you all again for coming out. I'm going to strike the stage.